Thank you for joining this Onc Live Peer Exchange, Moving the Needle in HCC, International Experts Weigh In. Comorbidities and underlying cirrhosis complicate the management of HCC. Recent advances, however, are improving survival and shedding light on optimal patient selection and multidisciplinary approaches. In this Onc Live Global Peer Exchange, I'm joined by a group of international experts in liver cancer who will provide a global perspective on screening, staging, and therapeutic sequencing strategies in advanced disease. We will also review the latest clinical trial evidence likely to impact clinical practice. I'm Dr. Richard Finn, and I'm an associate professor of medicine in the Division of Hematology Oncology at the Geffen School of Medicine at UCLA in Los Angeles. Joining me for this discussion are Dr. Jordi Bruix, head of the BCLC Group Liver Unit at the Hospital Clinic, University of Barcelona in Spain, Dr. Richard Marshall, Assistant Professor of Clinical Radiology and Associate Interventional Radiology Residency Program Director at the University Medical Center New Orleans of Louisiana Health Sciences Center in New Orleans, Louisiana. Dr. Amit Singal, Associate Professor of Medicine and Medical Director of the Liver Tumor Program at UT Southwestern Medical Center in Dallas, Texas, and Dr. Arndt Vogel, a Professor of Hanover Medical School in Hanover, Germany. Thank you for joining us. Let's begin. As represented by our panel here today, liver cancer is a very diverse group of malignancies with a global impact. Dr. Singal, can you talk to us about the differences globally in liver cancer?
Yeah, so Richard, as you know, HCC is the fifth most common tumor worldwide. And the highest incidence rates are actually in East Asia and in Africa. And in those areas, it's really driven by high rates of endemic hepatitis B. In Europe, United States, and most of actually the Americas, it actually has a much lower incidence and mortality rate than East Asia and Africa. And the actual risk factors are much different. Whereas those areas are mainly driven by hepatitis B, in the United States and in Europe, it's mainly driven by chronic hepatitis C, which is now also changing over time. With the new hepatitis C therapies, we've seen, hopefully, that the incidence for HCC will decrease in the future, and we're gonna see a shift in epidemiology from this really being a disease that's being driven by non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, which is related to obesity and diabetes. And so this is really gonna be the future of HCC, in my opinion, in the US and in Europe.
Yeah, it's been a very exciting time in the management of hepatitis C. Obviously, the impact of these new drugs curing hep C. And as you commented, there's gonna be a rise in the incidence of liver cancer from metabolic causes. You know, Dr. Vogel.
Could I comment one thing?
Sure.
To what extent do you think that there is an overlap between non-alcoholic steatohepatitis and really alcoholic liver damage? Because normally overweight comes with too much food, but normally too much food comes with too much drinking. Yeah. Do you think that this has been properly teased out?
I think it's tough. I think it's really, I mean, there is an ascertainment bias in terms of alcohol use. I mean, there are people that we know that drink that you ask them and they say, oh, I just have a couple beers. And so sometimes it is very difficult to tease those two apart. I think the other thing is I'm not sure if it really matters. I think that really these are probably two common pathways that you come in through different means, whether it's fat that's being derived from food or fat that's being derived from alcohol. I think it's really just two pathways to one single common pathway at the end. So, I think that we are seeing that there's probably some people that have alcohol in these patients who have metabolic syndrome, but there's probably some that also do not. What do you think? I mean, in Europe, I imagine it's also
I think that there is a big overlap. Obviously, both NASH and alcoholic liver disease come through mitochondrial damage and so on. But really, there is an overlap that has not been properly defined in epidemiological studies. And when you look to molecular signatures of the liver, there is no difference between NASH and alcoholic liver disease in some studies. So Probably what happens is that the interviews to register the amount of alcohol are not properly accurate.
Yeah.
And I think that this is something that we need to clarify.
And I think one final point on this is that we know that heavy alcohol use, we're pretty good at quantifying that. But I think the other question is, what is moderate alcohol use? Or what is light alcohol use? What does that add in terms of HCC risk? And so I think some of these things, you're right, will be important for us to figure out over the next few
years. This is something that also affects when you look to the etiology in liver cancer patients that come with at advanced stage. And so the intensity of the interview to clarify if they were drinking too much or not or so doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. So they have advanced cancer. And if you begin to ask, did you smoke 10 years ago? It will not be well taken by the patient. So epidemiologic studies have to be done as defined by epidemiologic knowledge.